All right. Last one. You ready? All right. I think this is going to be the last one. We're going to be talking about, there's been three other videos where we've talked about how to set these things up. We've talked about how to actually do some data preparation. How to do some modeling. We've talked about logging, etc. In this episode, we are going to be looking at how to actually take this model and deploy it out.
That's right.
Okay, show me how to do that.
Yeah, so essentially, like you mentioned, like eventually, like whenever you have a machine learning model, mm-hmm. you want to actually make it available to be used in some application. So what we are going to see next is whatever trained model, which we thought is the best, in this case, it's a random forest classifier, is exported into a pickle file. Mm-hmm. Basically, it's a serialized file, and then you can deploy it in the cloud.
I see. So this is where, because we've already looked at the experimentation service, yeah. we've already worked with the DSVM, yeah. now it's time to look at the model management portion of it. Okay. All right, let's dive in.
Yeah. So in this case, it's the same Jupyter notebook, you see. I just export that particular model as an output, and it's available in my assets folder.
And you use pickle, but you can use whatever you want, because yes. it's just something.
That's right.
But then later you do inference sequence.
That's right. Okay. Yeah, that's right. So once you have the model, you would want to score it, right? So essentially what I have over here, it's a scoring file, and I tell it that, okay, this is my model, and this is a sample data frame. Now generate a JSON file. The reason you need this JSON schema is you can tell your web service that this is how I expect the input, and go ahead and give me the output.
I see, so this thing right here, and I want to be clear because maybe there's some confusion with me. This file is effectively like, it will take a model yeah. that you've built and it will score it or do the inference or do the prediction.
That's right.
Those are the three synonymous things.
Yeah.
And the way you're doing it is there's just a run
yeah.
that's going to take the input as expected, the way you trained it.
Yeah.
And then in the main, it actually, if you run this file by itself, it will create like a schema that says, this is what I'm expecting, this is what I'm outputting.
That's right.
Okay,
perfect.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
So once you have that, you will again see that file in your project assets. So the schema is already available over here. Mm-hmm. Now, let's go ahead and actually create the service, so deploy it, right? Mm-hmm. So you remember last time I had shown you that you can use the command prompt.
Yes, right.
So we go to the same command prompt, which has the Azure ML CLI, right? And then you actually give the details about how you want to set up your cluster.
I see. And what is this? What is this cluster? This is where we're deploying the models to.
That's right.
Okay.
Now you have two options. Either you could deploy it in a Kubernetes cluster, which we created for you, mm-hmm. which is managed by our container service, or you could deploy it locally on your desktop if you already have Docker installed.
I see. Okay. And so, what's the difference between this cluster that's being set up and the model management piece? What's the difference?
So the model management, it's a single place where all your versions of the models are stored. Like say,
so it's just a physical model.
Yes, and under how it is stored, that's where we decide that whether it's a cluster or it's a local deployment.
I see.
And it gets tracked back. So think of it this way: like you have a model in this case, which we call it as income prediction, mm-hmm. and then the underlying is where is it actually running. It could be running locally or it could be running in the cluster, because when you are trying it out, you may not want to use the cluster, you just want to train locally, but when you are actually putting it in production, you use the cluster so you can scale it out.
So where does the actual model live? Does it live in the model management service, or does it live in the cluster, or does it live in your local machine?
It lives in the cluster mm-hmm. or on the local machine, depending on what you decide. In this case, we are going to decide the cluster, so it lives in the cluster.
I see, and model manager just keeps track of the ones that you've built.
That's right.
And it has information about that model, but it doesn't have the actual physical pickle file.
No.
Okay, cool, okay.
So in this case, the input which I'm giving is basically set up a particular cluster. Mm-hmm. In this case, this is the name of the cluster, the location where you want to set it up, and this parameter, --cluster, that's the magic. Like, we do all the hard work for you. So essentially what we do is we create the storage, we create the container registry, we create the Kubernetes cluster. By default, we use two nodes, mm-hmm. and then we also create an application insights, because essentially when your model is running, you actually want to use, how many API calls are there, and things like that.
And so if I have multiple different models, I can set this cluster up once and then push multiple models to that same cluster, is that true?
Yes, you can
cool.
do that.
So this might be something that you do one time,
yes.
and then later you scale out your cluster to add additional nodes to run additional models.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Cool.
So once you have done that, you can see that, okay, we can actually see what's the environment like. So in this case, you see that this is my cluster name, which you saw earlier. When was it deployed? The cluster size. Now we also give you an option to auto scale it. So based on like how much utilization is there, you can scale it up and down.
I see. And because this is interesting, right? Because the model file is self-contained, you can actually replicate into several different containers that are running the same thing, and it scales horizontally really well.
That's right. Cool. That's right. Yeah. Once you have that particular environment set up, you actually, with just one line, you can actually create the service. So here, what I'm giving here, I'm telling it that, okay, you remember the scoring
that's
file?
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's the file, and this is the model which we created. And then the JSON schema, which was output of that scoring file, right? And then this is the name of the application. So I'm just calling it a simple name. It's a Python-based stuff. And then the conda file, which we saw in
a couple of videos before. And this is interesting, right? Because when I'm looking at this, you use three files to define the service, how to run the inferencing, what you're running the inferencing on, and what the shape of the actual inferencing model is.
Yes.
And then it just sets up.
Yeah, so it's like one command, and it can take like 5-10 minutes, but it will do everything for you. So the output of this is essentially a service, which is now running in that cluster, and there will be an HTTP URL, which you can call in your application.
I see. And can you show us a little bit, like, because my guess is that this is like almost we're making our own cognitive services with our own custom model.
Yes.
Is there like a REST endpoint? How can we see what available calls there are?
Yeah, perfect. So actually, we show you all the options which are available. So there is a usage command, and this is my deployed model. So I'm just going to run that. So the output of the command is essentially telling you how many ways you can call that. So this is the IP address of the container, which is deployed in Azure right now. This is the way, like, how you call the header. And we believe in security, as you know, right?
Sure.
So essentially, there are authentication keys which you need to generate the first time, which you will use in your code when you're calling this API.
And effectively, when you're doing a get or a post, I think you just add in the header a bearer token.
That's right.
And you get that by running this particular command.
That's right.
Cool.
That's right. And the other way is you can even call this application using the CLI or PowerShell or any other way you would like. So we give you sample output over here.
And so if I want to run this right now, I just run this top command right here, and it even gives you sort of shape of what it is.
That's right. So in fact, why don't we go ahead and try this in the CLI, and then I'll show you how to call the HTTP as well. So.
So it looks like false.
Yes, that's right. So the income is less than 50K for this particular person.
That's fantastic. And you can because of the way that it's formed, you can actually return maybe even a confidence score or a tuple of something else, or you can return anything you want, and that way you can have more. But this is an easy way to show it as well.
That's right, you are right. So depending on the machine learning experiment, the way you have set it and the output, you can do that.
Fantastic. All right, well, what else you got to show? We've gone through like soup to nuts almost.
Yeah, so I one last thing I think probably I can show is the HTTP API.
Oh, of course. Yeah, let's take a look at that. Yeah.
So again, because I already have the Python environment in my AML workbench, I'm just going to call my Python code. So in this case, I'm providing the URL, which you saw earlier, the API key, and then I'm just passing it. And I can run it over here. Now, when it's running, so what I did was essentially gave an input data frame and to that URL, and then asked my workbench to run it. But you could run it outside in a command prompt anyway. And then I'm doing a print output. So essentially, in this case, it was a different person, and it's telling me that income is greater than 50,000.
And this, I mean, if you're looking at this Python code, this is just any kind of HTTP call. If you're a C-sharp dev and you're just an easy call, you're doing a Ruby call or a JSON call or a JavaScript call, it's just a get command that you're doing, but you're passing in some headers.
That's right. And we give you some sample examples on our documentation site where you can know how to call it as well.
Fantastic. Okay, so I think we've gone from the overview all the way to actually operationalizing a particular model. Why don't we go through just like a quick overview just to summarize what we did.
Okay, perfect. And in fact, I can show you visually how
what we did.
So here, what we did was we brought in, so the goal, as you know, it's to actually predict the income of a person given a set of in demographic data. So we have stored this data in Azure Blob Storage, and then we used Azure Machine Learning Workbench in order to create this experiment. Mm-hmm. Then we created a machine learning model, which we exported as a pickle file, or it could be any other file, and then we deployed it in the cloud. For the experimentation itself, we used a data science virtual machine, which we associated it with the notebooks within Workbench.
Right.
Now you could use HD Insight or things like
something
that as well,
else,
but
yeah,
but that's how it was. And then for the deployment, we again, because it's all Dockerized, we use the Azure Container Service, a Kubernetes-based cluster, but you could even use local, or you could even deploy it in IoT Edge or things like that. But this is somewhere.
I mean, it's pretty amazing. I mean, I know it's been a couple of videos, but I mean, we went through really fast the data science process. We're probably going to spend the most time in the experimentation area, trying to make sure where things work with data prep, etc. And then, obviously, like some of these commands, we made it go a little bit faster, but it takes a while to create a cluster.
Yes.
And so why don't you give some expectations on how long some of these things might take?
Sure, so that's a good point. So the first thing is creation of the data science virtual machine itself. It can take up to 5 minutes, depending on what it is. Again, time can vary, mm-hmm. so that is one part. The second time thing is the cluster deployment, essentially. So it can take up to 20 minutes, mm-hmm. because we are creating the entire environment for your storage.
You're making essentially like a whole, back in the day we used to have these buildings with all these computers that we'd have to like install stuff. You're literally creating a data center, yeah. A mini data center for these things.
That's right, and we also associate the scaling capability and insights, anyway. So that can take up to 20 minutes. The other time consuming thing could be the creation of the Docker image itself. Mm-hmm. So as you remember, we associated that virtual machine with our notebooks experience. Mm-hmm. So over there, we are actually creating a Docker image. So that can take 5 to 10 minutes, mm-hmm. as well.
But once you do these things one time, usually it's going to be pretty fast. Because I imagine that you're not going to be creating a cluster for each model that you're going to put out. I also imagine that you may have multiple VMs, but not very many. And once they're started, they're good to go.
Yeah.
And then creating these things once sets everything up.
Yeah. And the other thing is also the pricing. Like, you can control how much you are charged, because now you can stop those virtual machines or stop that cluster when you are not using it.
Fantastic. All right. So where can people go to find out more?
So I have the link over here on the slide, and essentially we walk you through starting videos, whatever we described in this video series. So the setup part, how to run your experiments, how to deploy it, and everything. So it's all available.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for this whirlwind tour of the Azure Machine Learning Services. There's a lot to enjoy and to use. Make sure you check it out. We'll put the links below. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time. Take care.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah.